Two Polar Bears Travel the World Supreme Edition, also known as Polar Bears. This is the first of several encounters with two polar bears named Snowglow and Glacia and their adventures together on the Alaska terrain and elsewhere. And each, this is actually the entire collection so far. And each chapter is and has its own story line and its own book. So this is the collection of books known as the Fairy Tale Little House of Miracles book collection. These two bears, Snowglow and Glacia, become iconic in their lives and a legend in their lifetimes together. It takes special bears to accomplish this feat, but they do it with grace and dignity. Learn about the secret lives of polar bears with new twists that mingle their lives with others. Come and explore new friends for life with two cuddly and intelligent polar bears like never before known in history. This book launched when I was telling my children stories before bedtime. And the polar bear on the iceberg story grew into what you now see as Two Polar Bears Travel the World and also Polar Bears. And I love this story. It will always be a heirloom for us. And it's a comfort and it's interesting and we never tire of it. On a cold and blustery day in the middle of winter, deep in an ice cave along the foothills of the Great Denali National Park Mountains, just south of the giant mountain range, a small hairless polar bear cub was born. Its mother, Starlight, licked him all over as she inspected him and drew him close to her teat so he could drink her fresh warm milk, made especially for him. She named him Snowglow, and he was the apple of his mother's eye. She kept him clean, dry, and well-fed for several months, in which time he grew in size from about 14 inches long and 20 to 20 pounds, and a few pounds to the size of a medium-sized dog come spring. Not far from Snowglow and his mother's cave was another mama polar bear, Natalie, who had just given birth to her single baby girl cub named Glacia at nearly the same time as Snowglow's birth. Each newborn cub weighed about 1.5 pounds and were about a foot long. They were the most recent addition on the frozen terrain where they lived. They were the new sea bears on the block, so to say, because polar bears mean sea bear. The cubs would spend the next 3 to 4 months in their caves with their mothers. Both cubs were Christmas babies, and they were loved and adored by their mamas. The outside temperatures often hit well below 0 degrees Fahrenheit and as low as negative 45 degrees Fahrenheit more times than not. The cubs never felt cold or hungry in their den when their mother was present, because the warmth from their mother provided heat and warmth from their mother. Snowglow was a little bigger than Glacia, but what she lacked in size, she made up for in bearing and attitude. She could nearly do everything that Snowglow could do. Snowglow was just emerging from his cave with his mother on this fine early spring day in April. The cold zapped his little baby nose as Arctic air hit it, mixed with the faintest hint of spring warmth touching his fur. He looked straight ahead and saw the giant mountains of the Denali rising above him and his mama. His eyes looked higher and higher until his neck strained with the effort. Then he saw the giant blue sky above, and he suddenly sneezed. The cold reached high into his nose and tickled it until he giggled. He tried to follow in the footsteps of Mama, but he had trouble. They were headed up a slope, and he slid backwards, tumbling in little somersaults back to their cave. Little Glacia was finding it as difficult as Snowglow to follow her mother up the slope as well. Starlight looked at Natalie, sighed, and said, "Well, it may be a while yet before we can actually take these cubs somewhere, because there's simply too much snow for them to get far on, especially on the slopes." Both mothers retraced their steps back to their caves with their cubs and carefully closed the opening most of the way to keep out the icy cold air. From their dens. Snowglow loved the comfort of his cave den, and he loved all the undivided attention of his mother. They snuggled close together as another snowstorm besieged their habitat. Snow fell light as air, piling up more than 10 feet, and the winds howled day and night. It was a good thing Starlight had so thoughtfully and instinctively ate an abundance of food in the autumn before she went into hibernation. She had eaten so well and so much that she still had plenty of fat on her body to sustain her while she nursed and raised her baby. She was not so hungry that she must leave the den and her cub to forage for food. She had time to do that later, when the snow melted a little more. Snowglow spent his cubhood in joy and happiness as he nestled into the warm, thick fur of Starlight. As the days went by inside the cave, the storms outside came and went, but Snowglow only knew how happy his days were with his mama in the warm cave den. The days turned into weeks, and Snowglow grew a little bigger with every day. Then it was time for Starlight to venture out of her den to inspect the area around her home and her hunting grounds. Starlight looked at her son and spoke to him in gentle grunts and purring sounds, saying, "You must stay here until I return. Do not leave our home. I will be back as soon as I can. You must wait here until I return. I love you, Snowglow. Be good." Starlight left Snowglow in the cave and gently covered the hole that led into the cave to protect Snowglow from any predators that might try to bother him. She padded off toward the sea to find seals to eat and other edible foods she enjoyed. She would be back as soon as she could find food. Snowglow whimpered softly to himself in the cave and began to entertain himself with various activities. First, he played with his stubby little white furry tail and chased it until he was too tired to anymore. He looked about the big cave, and his eyes widened with wonder as his eyes followed every shadow and shape cast upon the walls of his cave. Suddenly he noticed that there was movement in the cave with him. Every time he moved, the thing moved too. If he went one way, the thing went that way too. If he moved the other way, the thing did as well. Every time Snowglow did anything at all, the thing would do it too. Snowglow could not understand what was happening. He decided to play hide and seek with it. When he hid from the thing, it seemed to hide as well. What in the world was going on here? Snowglow asked himself. It didn't matter too much now because he was too tired out to care, so long as the thing didn't bite him or bother him. Snowglow fell softly to sleep in his warm, comfortable den. When morning came, Snowglow woke up, but he had not forgotten about the thing in his cave with him. After he opened his eyes, he saw the thing that was with him in the cave. Nothing moved. Maybe the thing was all right and not anything to be afraid of. So he peered into the depths of his cave and tried with all his might to be brave. His nose trembled as he tried to smell out the thing, but he couldn't detect anything unusual there. From that point on, Snowglow would not fear the thing that lived in his home with him and his mother. But he still liked to play with it when he was lonesome. Then he suddenly realized that the thing was only his shadow after all. The days went by one, a week went by, and then another. Snowglow was getting very hungry, and he wanted his mother to come home now. Still, she did not come for a while longer. Snowglow woke up from a happy dream when his mother nuzzled his face and licked him all over with joy at seeing him again. He rolled over onto his back, and Starlight sniffed his little tummy, and then she licked it too. Snowglow was so happy, he felt like he was in heaven. Snowglow said, "I am so hungry, Mama. Can I have some milk?" Mama lay down so Snowglow could get all the milk he wanted. Then he fell fast asleep with his round tummy full of warm milk. His face was lit up with joy as he dreamed once more. Starlight took a deep sigh of relief. "Ah, home at last with my little son. I am so happy to get home." She pondered in her mind the difficulty she had faced as she hunted for food to keep her going for several more months if necessary. She had happened by a seal carcass that had been eaten earlier by another polar bear. It was very fortunate that the bear had left so much of the seal for her to eat. She ate to her heart's content, thoroughly cleaned her paws and face. Then she lowered her face into the snow and glided along it to get her soft fur as clean as possible. Cool and refreshing was the feeling, besides a plump tummy full of nutritious seal meat. Then back to her den to see her baby. Well, he wasn't quite a baby really now, but he was still very small and he needed her about as much as she needed him in her life. The mother and child bond was like a twin candle burning warm in their hearts. Snowglow woke up and peered up at his lovely mother. He wanted to be just like her when he grew up, because she was good, gentle, and kind to him. A happy purr rose up out of his throat as he playfully cuffed his mother on the nose with one small paw. Starlight pretended not to notice anything unusual and proceeded to ignore the playful cuff. Then Snowglow rose up on his hind legs and licked his mama on the nose several times. He could smell the seal meat. He could smell the meat she had eaten, but he didn't know what it was. He tried to hug his mother, but she was just too big for him to get his paws around her neck. So he settled for a partial low-down hug near her lower chest instead. Cubs will be cubs. As the spring days improved with more sunshine and warmer days, Starlight traveled everywhere with Snowglow. They were virtually inseparable. Glacia and her mother, Natalie, were also venturing forth into the big wide world with, like Snowglow and his mom. Often they would play together. As their mother stood by watching their cubs and basking in the chill summer breezes blowing by. Now the cubs were enjoying the last of the summer days and preparing for winter hibernation with their mothers. The cubs would go to the seaside with their moms and wait patiently for them to come back to shore. The adult bears needed seal meat, which meant that they had to go out to sea on exploration hunting for seals. The polar bears were excellent hunters and swimmers, with special webbed skin between their toes for better swimming capabilities. Some polar bears could swim 60 miles before they needed to rest on an iceberg or land. Snowglow's mother could almost swim that far because she was still in her prime time of life, the best and healthiest time for her. The cubs played along the shoreline, waiting but acting like they weren't. As they skirted the shore, pounced on each other, played hide and seek, wrestled and wrangled with each other until they were fairly exhausted. Time flew by, and then they saw their mothers coming from the ocean dripping wet. Starlight shook the seawater from her thick fur coat as a rainbow encircled her body as the icy spray flew off her fur. Natalie came out of the sea next and shook just as Starlight did, and another rainbow graced her figure in the process. Snowglow and Glacia tilted their heads to one side and then the next as they amused themselves with the wonder of the rainbows about them. Starlight said to Glacia, "Wow, I want to make a rainbow like that too." But he did not know what or how to make it happen. Then Snowglow startled when Glacia unexpectedly swiped her paw right at his left ear, then took off running as fast as she could, calling out, "Hot lava monster, you can't catch me, Snowglow, because I can run faster than you." Off she ran at a new record speed for her, but Snowglow would not let her win this game, and he lurked ahead and tried to cut her off in a shortcut tactical maneuver. Glacia was speedier than Snowglow on this day, and little Snowglow didn't have a chance in catching up with her until she slowed down on her own accord. Glacia had a smug look of satisfaction on her face when Snowglow caught up with her and said with a gleam in her eyes, "I told you so. You can't keep up with me, but I still like you anyway." Then both cubs scampered back in unison toward their mothers, with their ears blowing in the wind behind them, and their stubby little tails wiggling as they came. The cubs were as precious as two clear white diamonds skirting the snow, as though they were mere butterflies because they were so light on their toes. Starlight and Natalie could not love, appreciate, or adore their cubs more than they did. The polar bears made a beeline for their prospective dens, taking frequent rests along the way, until finally they made it home. Glacia and Natalie said, "Good night, everyone. We'll see you soon. Have a good rest. Everyone deserves it." Arctica. They tried and tried to catch up with the northern lights, but it was like trying to chase a rainbow. Every time they got near it, the lights drifted further off into the distance, so off they went again. They had journeyed quite far by now and lost all track of time. The bears thought it was a game they were playing called Chase the Colors. They kept playing until they tired of it long enough to take a short rest before they were once again on the Aurora Borealis trail. The days slipped by and nights too. Suddenly, they were no longer in the Denali area of Alaska. They had gone far to the north into the great and grand and wonderful Arctic Circle. Glacia said, Let's try to catch it if we can, Snowglow. She hurtled her body high into the air, trying to catch the dancing rays of colors, falling in a somersault each time. Snowglow followed Glacia's idea, and he jumped as high as he could go and fell down just like Glacia. They both jumped up at the same time, came down hard, landing on each other, and rolled down the slope they were on in a big tumbling sprawl of giggles and laughter. They looked around and realized that they could probably never, ever catch the beautiful rainbow colors dancing in the sky. They sat on their haunches and began to take notice of what was around them in the beautiful Arctic Circle. They saw many animals, creatures, trees, and beautiful things. The Arctic Circle held many beautiful plants and animals that they were looking at with curiosity and interest. First, they saw the Arctic tundra, which was composed of plants like dwarf shrubs, graminoids, herbs, lichens, and mosses, which all grow relatively close to the ground. They did not see many tall trees, mainly dwarf evergreens that looked like the aged Monterey pines in Northern California and along the coast north of there throughout Southern Alaska. Some of the animals they saw along the way were the Arctic fox, lemmings, muskox, caribou, and wolves. They also saw wolverines, ermines, Arctic ground squirrels, and mice roaming about or hiding under cover. They saw some ice further north and went to see if their mothers might be there. The cubs did not have a good understanding of space, time, and distance as they proceeded onto the ice pack of the beautiful Arctic area. Along the way, they had seen lots of marine life, such as seals, walrus, baleen whales, narwhals, killer whales, and belugas. The bears were almost ready to hunt for seal meat, but they needed just a little more maturing and growing up for this to take place. Glacia and Snowglow practiced and pretended to pounce and snare seals they saw along their travels. Some instinctual insight came upon Snowglow and Glacia as they realized that they were not near their beloved Denali Mountains and knew they must return there. They had found a recently dead seal and ate it up as fast as they could and wiped their faces and fur as clean as possible in the snow. They proceeded to backtrack along their trails until they eventually made it all the way back home themselves. They came upon their mothers not far from their dens and gleefully pounced upon them in joy and excitement of being home again. Starlight and Natalie were on the verge of setting out into the north to find their cubs. They had recently returned from their hunting trip to find their cubs not there. They waited for the cubs to return on their own. They waited and waited and could wait no more when they began to head out in search of them. This was when all four met together in a happy reunion. Starlight and Natalie asked, "Where were you and what did you do? You know better than to run off like you did. Whatever happened?" Snowglow replied, "Well, we saw some beautiful dancing colors in the sky." Then Glacia finished with, "So we wanted to catch them and see what they were made of so we could play with them." Starlight and Natalie gave each other a long, curious look, then looked straight at their cubs and nodded their heads like the wise ones they were. They knew all about the pulling features of the Northern Lights and knew that was why their cubs had been led away. Each mother bear led her cub to their respective dens and settled down for a long and comfortable nap, cuddled up close together just as they had done so many times before. Traveling to Japan. The sun retreated once more and winds out of the east picked up, causing the iceberg to drift at a greater pace toward the Pacific Ocean. It was fortunate that the bears had drifted on a very sturdy and rather giant iceberg that was about the length and width of 75 football fields. The iceberg was, it was much deeper than that beneath the sea's surface. Snowglow and Glacia were not in the least bit concerned that land was getting further away, and they were not yet missing their mothers because they were nearly adults now. They were brave and adventuresome. They drifted out to sea on an unusual adventure of a lifetime that would affect the rest of their lives. Nor did they realize how long they would be away or whether they would ever return. The storms rolled by and the sun would return, and these cycles kept on day after day as Snowglow and Glacia sailed into the west and their future. It was the ocean currents that drove the iceberg. The ocean currents were controlled by the winds, the moon, the sun, and other natural factors such as underlying ocean rivers beneath the iceberg. The northern Pacific Ocean seemed to pitch the giant iceberg into a pattern like that of a whirlpool as the iceberg got caught up in a web within the sea. They waited for the ocean gridlock to end so they might resume sailing the high seas again. The bears were in limbo as the whirlpool moved them in tireless circles when suddenly a new storm came upon them and shifted the iceberg in a westerly direction, moving them right towards Asia. Snowglow and Glacia were not hungry because they could swim in the ocean and under it as well to find their favorite food source, which was seals. The iceberg was once again in a sea grip where it seemed to be anchored to the ocean in one spot. Glacia and Snowglow were eager to investigate the land that was not very far from their iceberg. The two polar bears swam towards shore to investigate their new surroundings. They could easily see their iceberg from island once they got to land. Food was plentiful for the bears as they honed in to the shore of Japan, where they landed on one moonlit night in the coldest of winters. At dawn, as dawn came, they saw a beautiful country spread out before them with wonderful fragrances of fish, spices, flowers, and volcanic earth. The bears had arrived on the northernmost part of Japan called Hokkaido. The natural lakes and flowers that abounded here delighted the polar bears. They peeked from behind bushes to look at the giant white cranes gracefully standing in shallow lakes. Occasionally, tall white cranes stood on one leg in the lakes or dipped their bills into the sandy bottoms, searching for shrimp or other small fish and snails to feed upon. They explored the islands, plants, and wild birds that presided in the gardens. Glacia was even more entranced with the gardens than Snowglow, and she did not want to leave the gardens because they appealed to her so much to her. It was colder here than in southern Japan, and it was quiet compared to Tokyo, with its multitude of people flanking the largest island in the chain of islands that made up Japan. The pollution and damage done by humans was not evident on Hokkaido. Here Glacia and Snowglow found the peace from the countryside calming and relaxing after their harrowing trip west across the Pacific Ocean. All too soon they knew they must return to their iceberg ship out to sea, so they left, better for the experienced and enriched with the goodness of Japan filling their hearts. Snowglow led Glacia to their iceberg, and with the powerful strokes of their arms and legs, they made fast progress. They arrived soon after they left land to climb up the sides of the iceberg and rest on top of it while they watched the land slide past them. As the iceberg drifted south along the Japanese shoreline, the day turned to night and back to day. They had come to Honshu, the largest of the Japanese islands, and also the beautiful volcanic mountain looming up from the land called Mount Fuji that captivated their attention most. Dawn was upon them, and the sun coming up kissed the top of Mount Fuji as it rose high into the heavens like a pinnacle of fire. It mesmerized them, and they stopped in their tracks to admire the great beauty of the volcanic mountain. Their excitement mounted as they leapt into the sea for a quick splash together to make the moment extra memorable. The swells had kicked up with the late morning winds, and the waves were high and terrible. Glacia and Snowglow found a perch on top of their iceberg island not far from their den, where they watched as Mount Fuji became a red spot in the distance. The ice island lurched once more with the swells of the sea as the iceberg moved once more, this time in a southern direction, well off the coast of Japan. The sun retreated once more, and winds out of the east picked up, causing the iceberg to drift at a greater pace towards the Indian Ocean. It was fortunate that the bears had drifted on a very sturdy and rather giant iceberg that was so vast in size. As wide and long as the iceberg was, it was much deeper than that beneath the sea's surface. Snowglow and Glacia were not in the least bit concerned that land was getting further away. And they were not yet missing their mothers because they were nearly adults now. they thought they would see them again. They drifted out to sea on an unusual adventure of a lifetime that would affect the rest of their lives, nor did they realize how long they would be away, or whether they would ever return. The storms rolled by, and the sun would return, and these cycles kept on day after day. As Snowglow and Glacia sailed into the future, it was the ocean currents that drove the iceberg. The ocean currents took control of the iceberg once more, sending it along on a very long journey indeed. The northern Pacific Ocean pitched a giant, caught up their mighty iceberg ship, and sent it sailing into the high seas again. The bears were in limbo as the whirlpool moved them in tireless circles until they were dizzy again, when suddenly a new storm came upon them and shifted their iceberg in a southerly direction, moving them right towards Asia. Glacia and Snowglow found a perch on top of their iceberg island not far from their den, where they watched Mount Fuji become red spot in the distance. The ice island lurched once more with the swells of the sea as the iceberg moved once more, this time in a southern direction, well off the coast of Japan. On to China. The two bears were on the go once again as their iceberg flowed in a southern direction well off the coast of Japan, headed toward the central Chinese coast. The sights and sounds of human activity were everywhere they looked. From the seas off China's coast to the land itself were countless numbers of humanity and human activity. Ships almost as large as their iceberg swarmed the harbors as they drifted by in the dark of another moonless night. Bad air everywhere burned Glacia and Snowglow's noses from human factories and activities. The icy island moved to a quiet zone where there were hardly any people about. This is where their iceberg stalled conveniently for the polar bears to hop off it and swim to shore in the cloak of night. This is where they would begin their exploration of China and the country itself. They explored some of the beautiful Chinese countryside, Haikou, in the southeastern part of China, is where the iceberg stalled. This was the perfect place for it to do so because Glacia and Snowglow would be able to take in vast areas of the country while being inauspicious as possible. For the polar bears were of a mind to keep to themselves. They did not want to mingle with humans. This land was a circular outcropping of land, making it very beautiful and unusual. A fairy circle, really. The moonless night did not deter the polar bears as they went on their adventure through China. With the light from the early dawn, Glacia and Snowglow made good progress as they mingled with the plants, shrubs, and trees along their path. Though tired, the polar bears had plenty of energy to carry them far into the interior of China. Fortunately, the bears came upon a train thought to have been abandoned long ago. Glacia and Snowglow sniffed at the car, attracted to the smell of sushi it contained. The sushi was stored in refrigerated barrels, stacked high in the refrigerated car of the train. Snowglow and Glacia's eyes lit up like diamonds on fire. Glacia said, "Snowglow, is this amazing treat or what? This food is so good, it is hard to not eat it up in one big bite." Snowglow looked dizzy with delight as they both downed the fish. As Glacia and Snowglow sniffed at the remaining sushi barrels, even though they just ate a barrel of it, the remaining barrels of sushi made them hungry all over again, as the smells made their mouths water and drool. Such a combination of abundant and seemingly endless sushi delights awaiting them here for the taking, and take it they would. As soon as Snowglow and Glacia were determining which barrel they should open first, they heard a clanking of metal on metal. And suddenly the car began to move forward into the moonlit wee hours of the morning. The engine could suddenly be heard above the clanking of the tires as the screeching along the old railroad tracks heading into the interior of China's most precious and glorious assets where panda bears still lived in limited numbers and where Tibetan monks tried to care for the land. The train gathered speed and quickly and then took the fast track, zooming through the provinces and cities all along the way. Glacia looked at Snowglow and he looked back at her. But though they should have been more concerned than they seemed, the barrel of sushi overwhelmed their usual common sense and all caution sailed away. The engine's grinding didn't bring back sensibility to the polar bears. All caution was lost in the wind. Snowglow and Glacia were tasting gourmet treats they had not known existed, and they ate to their heart's content. Nothing mattered to the two polar bears at the moment other than the two sushi barrels they had just emptied and the next two they were about to eat. The train was a non-stop train moving straight to the southwestern corner of China for a very important event that would be held there to speak of preservation of natural resources and other topics of that subject. Too many people were traveling to see pandas in their natural environment. People were so abundant to these areas that the natural land was changing as a result, making the panda habitat a fragile place and ecosystem. The train made it to the interior and finally stopped in the giant valley of many lakes and falls, the Jinhaigu, Sichuan province. Glacia and Snowglow peered out of the train car and wonder filled their faces as they looked out upon the scene that unfolded before them. The high winter zone seemed to forget that it was already winter because autumn was still lingering here and holding fast before the winter wonderland of snow and frost invaded the territory all around them. The sights that opened up before Snowglow and Glacia's eyes was no less fantastic than their own winter wonderland in the great far north of their natural polar bear habitat in the Denali National Park in Alaska. First, Snowglow's eyes fell open, and then Glacia's eyes followed suit as they looked around them in astonishment. They were delighted by the sight that unfolded before them. They saw great bodies of lakes everywhere. They looked and falls cascading down from one lake to the next in a symphony of music and beauty that would be hard to match anywhere else on the planet. The whole valley looked like it was made of ancient rock formations, which made the lakes the shape and size they were from ancient glacier activity. The lakes had lovely bowl shapes in many instances, and the lakes overflowed into lovely falls that rolled down via rivers to the next lake, which in turn overflowed to another lake, and so on and so forth. This is also known as the Hundred Lakes and Falls. The symphony of lakes and falls enchanted the polar bears and mesmerized them. The sky was beautiful, but the high glacier mountain trapped pollution from the major cities of China, making it somewhat difficult for the bears to breathe as well and as freely as they would have liked to. The large numbers of humanity visiting there did not disturb the polar bears too much because Glacia and Snowglow stayed hidden and out of view of them. They made a dash beyond the train door and met Wonderland itself. They played in the water, drank in the mountain air, and scampered like bitty cubs toward Bamboo Arrow Falls, where they drank long, cool gulps of clear water falling from the lake above. The two bears felt like this is what heaven must be like, for it was so beautiful and glorious. They looked upward and happened to see a young panda bear peering back at them from high up in the bamboo trees. Above the falls, they stayed overnight in this special area and drank in all the goodness about them. And then they remembered the sushi in the train car where they had left it. So they headed back toward the car with sushi in it and sniffed around the car before climbing inside it. The coast was clear, so they climbed back into the car to get some more. Just then the door closed upon them and the train started its long journey back to the coast of China in a non-stop route. There was still sushi aboard the train because somebody had forgotten to take it all out of the car. So there was ample sushi to eat. On the way back down the mountain toward the sea, day turned to night and back again twice before the train came to a stop at a rural depot outside of a small coastal town. The polar bears escaped from the train moments after the train attendant opened the doors, and away they went down to the shore to begin their long swim back to their iceberg, still waiting for them where they had left it a few days before. Beautiful images of panda bears and bejeweled cascading lakes and falls filled their minds as they made their way to their icy island waiting for them. Once aboard the iceberg and ensconced in their den, sweet dreams of sushi sailed through their hearts and minds. the iceberg began to sail once more. India. The iceberg caught a swift ocean current that carried Snowglow and Glacia, who slept in sweet heavenly slumber with extended stomachs full of sushi. They slept cuddled up close to each other with Snowglow's big paw gently resting on Glacia's shoulder. Happy polar bear sounds gently escaped from their lips as purring and grunting noises arose from their chests as they slumbered in their den. The iceberg sailed on through the days and into the nights as it moved in a curious southerly direction, making its way toward India via the outcropping countries of Malaysia and Singapore. The iceberg kept most of its shape intact for the most part thus far on the journey. The floating island moved in a somewhat steady pace north and then northwest of Krakatoa, one of the largest volcanoes on Earth, called a super volcano. The volcano was quiet and had been rather dormant for quite some time. Then Snowglow and Glacia neared the Indian coast from its most northern direction. As the polar bears neared the northeastern coast of India, they became very restless on their ice island and were eager to explore the country looming up before them. The iceberg had been losing some of its size as it left the Chinese coast, then stabilized as it neared the more winterized zone of the Indian territory, because it was becoming winter in India. The polar bears had emerged from their den. After they passed Krakatoa Island, their senses were jumping out of their skins with the essence still surrounding that zone from the last eruption so long ago. Their ears perked up as new aromas reached them from India, filled with spices, earth, life, and the land itself. The bears were so excited to get on shore for a break from their iceberg that they were becoming almost irritable with anxious anticipation. They practically were pawing the ground like bulls when their opportunity arose to swim to shore at the farthest northeast coastal area of India. The iceberg settled itself in an extra cold area, well off the coast, enabling the polar bears to swim at their leisure to the shore. The bears stayed close together, as was to be expected. Snowglow led the way for Glacia as they slowly moved their giant heads one way and then the other as they read the story of the land with their noses and every fiber of their beings. They could discover many things from their surroundings and other things much further away in this manner. Snowglow was good for picking up certain things, while Glacia was better at collecting some of what Snowglow was detecting, as well as other things that Snowglow could not pick up through his sensory perceptions. The two bears complemented one another quite well in this respect, creating a very full picture of data collected and shared between the two of them. Normally, polar bears don't travel together like Snowglow and Glacia. Male polar bears can be seen together, and female polar bears teamed together. But overall, males tended to stay away from the female polar bears. The male polar bears were often much larger than female polar bears by as much as 500 pounds or so. And they were often very aggressive and ready for a good fight at the least likely provocation. But Snowglow was not a typical polar bear because he was a gentle-hearted bear, much wiser than the average intelligent polar bear. Glacia was completely at ease around Snowglow, and she trusted and loved him greatly, with her big, loving heart. This loving and trusting bond between Snowglow and Glacia was very strong and enduring, and anyone who looked upon the two of them together could see that their love would last them throughout their lives together. The bears had concluded their initial examination of the lands before them through their extreme sensory and intuitive exploration of collective data. The two cautiously moved towards the island inland. They instinctively headed toward the high mountain ranges surrounding Mount Everest, avoiding people wherever they went, for they would not survive freely if they had. They moved mainly by night, following the high moonlight lit ground below. This was all new terrain for them, but they felt compelled to go toward the high mountain regions of India. The weather was increasingly colder. Deeper and higher they went into the high mountainous regions of the foothills of the Himalayas. Something was quite extraordinary about this area of India. The air got colder, the winds blew without ceasing, and excitement seemed to grow within Glacia and Snowglow as they steadily climbed upward. The air became thin and it became more difficult for the bears to breathe because there was less oxygen in the air the higher they went. Sparkles shined from their eyes as they looked about and saw high mountain rhododendrons and colorful Tibetan flags showing. Slowing at various points along their route and showing. Snowglow stopped suddenly, and so did Glacia when they came upon a sight they would never forget. The scenery before them opened up into the most amazing mountain ranges they had ever seen, even more large and powerful than their majestic Mount Denali mountain range in Alaska where they had started their journey. They saw the mountains cluster together, Mount Everest, Emma Dablam, which means mother and her necklace. All they could do was look and look and look some more at a sight before them that they would never forget, for it was so spectacular. They thought of climbing up those mountains to see what they might see, but the trip up there seemed too much for them to do. So they just stared up at the high mountain peaks and took in the breathtaking views that surrounded them everywhere they looked. Time seemed to stand still here as they stood close together with their fur touching. They looked all about them everywhere with astonishment, then at each other, and smiled with great satisfaction spread across their faces. They hunkered down for the night in a natural den made of huge rocks, where they also found refuge from the icy wind that ripped through the high mountainous zone. The den gave them all the comfort they could hope for in the extreme weather conditions of the Himalaya mountain range. They rose the next day and looked some more at the beautiful mountains before they wound their way back down the great mountains and foothills of the Himalaya toward their icy island off the Indian coast. This is Mount Everest. They once more traveled by night on their path leading toward the coast and eventually to their floating home, away from home, their personal iceberg. After what seemed a long time and many days, they came to the beach and saw their iceberg still floating where they had pretty much left it offshore. It had not moved much, if any bit at all. They had seen many Indian animals, and the baby elephant was the most startling to them. Its big luminous eyes stole their hearts. They trudged onward. The bears had not eaten since their sushi fish meals they had eaten from the wooden barrels on board the train in China, and they were getting to be a little hungry. They needed to get to their iceberg and then find some seal meat or other fish, preferably seal because that was their favorite food next to sushi. They saw lovely dolphins dancing in the light. Australian Great Barrier Reef. The polar bears headed south past Malaysia and Indonesia as they drifted on the ocean current toward Australia. Now the bears were very, very hungry, and they had seals on their minds as their tummies began to rumble from hunger. Most any fish would do about now. Snowglow motioned to Glacier with his nose in the air, saying, "We must get some more food soon because I am very hungry." Glacier nodded her assent and replied, "Me too, Snowglow. I think I smell food near here we'd like to eat." The aroma of seal hit their noses with a slam, and the next minute they were in the ocean paddling towards their quarry. A huge group of seals hunting their meals not far off from the bears. Before the seals could all get to safety, a sick older seal failed to swim away fast enough with the rest of his group. He didn't know what he was in for because the bears came at him so suddenly. They brought it back to their iceberg where they ate until there was none left. They had nearly finished it in no time flat. The seal meat would provide them with the blubber they loved so well, and the meat that would fortify their bodies, giving them strength to continue on their ventures until hopefully they could return to their homelands in the great north of Alaska. They licked their chops and cleaned their fur, then cleaned one another's fur too. Their bellies were round and full of food as they nestled together in the sunshine on their ice island floating onwards toward Australia. The wind picked up once again, with gale-force winds, sending them quickly on their way. The air began to have scents of special and far-away land that drifted among the sea salt of the breeze. Glacier looked at Snowglow with stars shining in her eyes, and she told him, "Snowglow, I smell many new and wonderful scents in the air, and I think we will be in for a pleasant surprise when we get to where these scents are coming from." Her big black nose wiggled, and her great big brown eyes squinted tightly as she inhaled the air with every fiber of her body. Snowglow perked up his ears with Glacier's words, and he gently pawed the iceberg and shook his head, saying, "Yes." They stood near the front of the iceberg, like two captains on a mighty ship sailing exactly to the destination they sought. These polar bears felt instinctively that they would eventually find their way back home in Alaska. They did not doubt that it would be so, and they trusted that this is exactly how things would turn out to be. With wind speeds picking up to 45 miles per hour, out of the northeast, and the white kept blowing spray as the crests of the waves rose. High in the air, the bears made great time moving toward Australia. They moved night and day and skirted the south shore of New Guinea as they moved, heading towards the large landmass, until finally, on a cold, foggy morning, the seas once more lie down to rest. It seemed to stand still once more as the sea lapped at the iceberg. The exact location of the stalled iceberg was not expected by the polar bears because they had arrived rather further north and east of where they had anticipated. They were within swimming distance of land and something else quite entirely. Glacia and Snowglow found themselves looking straight down the depths just north of the Great Barrier Reef. The reef itself was in great need of the cold Arctic waters that arrived with the stormy sea currents that had also carried Snowglow and Glacia. The reef had been nearly starving to death, as the coral beds and their inhabitants were holding on to dear life, just waiting for the cold ocean currents to bring them the nutrients and food they needed for their survival. The cold ocean current flowed swiftly across the reef, merging with the warm waters that had become nearly too warm for the reef corals and other animals and fish to survive. The polar bears had become part of the rescue mission of the plight and fate of the Great Barrier Reef. The reef would now survive for many more months because of the much-needed elements brought its way. Glacia and Snowglow didn't want to waste a moment more on the iceberg when they could be out exploring this new phenomenon they had discovered together. Snowglow led the way into the sea with Glacia close behind him. They swam towards the coral reef with eyes opened wide and bright because what they saw was astounding them. The bears dived into the depths of the coral reef once more. They reached them, and their swim motion slowed down considerably as they looked some more, and then grinned from ear to ear. The sights they beheld were mesmerizing the polar bears. Glacia felt like she could swim around among these corals for the rest of her life and never get tired of what she beheld. Snowglow was just as amused and perplexed by what he saw before him as well. He grinned widely at Glacia and did a little dance of happiness in the water to show how perfectly happy he was inside. The bears were so happy they could hardly contain themselves. This is what they saw before them, beneath them, and all around them. A clear and beautiful ocean surrounding their underwater paradise. Corals of every color and type greeted their eyes. Brain corals, sea fan corals, sponges, clownfish, leafy sea dragons, seahorses, and so much more. The reef was swimming with life of every kind. Sea turtles dove just beyond their reach. Sharks and rays danced in the currents, some chasing fish and others at ease, resting here and there. Dolphins and porpoises played and frolicked the day away as killer whales kept in their pods nearby. Seals and blue penguins swam by at high speeds as the penguins tried tactical maneuvers to evade the seals. Most of the penguins made it safely out of the way from their predators. The bears had to surge forth out of the water for fresh gulps of air from the surface now and again as they searched the depths of the reef. Eventually, they became all tired out and headed back toward their icy island for rest and recuperation from all their exertions and enterprises of the day. They found a perfectly cool spot on their iceberg to rest upon as they drifted into a pleasant nap for the afternoon. They dreamed about the reef they had just encountered and of all the plants and animals they had seen, most of which they had never encountered before. This is a green sea turtle, and he eats algae. The algae helps keep him the color he is. The night came, and the ocean stirred once more, making the great iceberg shift its course and spin about, heading due south as it made its way down the eastern Australian coast. The Australian currents were strong and swift as they swept the polar bears due south. It was headed to the southeastern coast of Australia, and it veered in a southerly route once it found clear sailing. The ocean winds once more died down, and the iceberg came to a virtual stop just east of the landmass of Australia. It was nearly upon the 12 apostles just offshore. Glacia and Snowglow didn't waste a moment as they leaped into the brisk waters off the coast and began to swim to shore. The rolling waves brought them gently to shore where they navigated past the huge rock formations that made up the 12 apostles. Then they were on the sandy beach and shook the sea from their fur, and rainbows danced about them with every quiver. The stormy seas had brought extra cold water with them, and that is where the iceberg now nestled. Australian 12 Apostles. The ocean winds once more died down, and the iceberg came to a virtual stop at the southeastern most portion of Australia in Victoria State off the east coast. The ocean current had brought the iceberg carrying Snowglow and Glacia far south of the Great Barrier Reef. They had nearly landed upon the 12 Apostles just offshore. Glacia and Snowglow didn't waste a moment as they leaped into the brisk waters off the coast and began to swim to shore. The rolling waves brought them gently to shore, where they navigated past the huge rock formations that made up the 12 apostles. Then they were on the sandy beach and shook the sea from their fur, and rainbows danced about them with every shake. The stormy seas had brought extra cold water with them, and that is where the iceberg now nestled just offshore of Australia. They glanced back toward their iceberg home a few times before they walked along the sandy shore and drank in all the flavors that came to their senses from inland Australia. Glacia motioned to Snowglow with a twist of her head to show him that she wanted to climb the bluffs to explore the uplands with him. Snowglow said, "Come on, Glacia, let's go and see what's up there in those tall swaying grasses blowing along the bluffs above. By following an ancient kangaroo trail that was still used now." Glacia was first to the top, and she waited until Snowglow caught up with her. They both eyed the surroundings and perked up their ears as the west winds blew through their luxurious clear coats, making them appear to be like two giant dandelion puffballs. They meandered along the bluff for a while, amusing themselves with the unfamiliar scents of new animals that they had not known before. Off in the distance, they saw kangaroos jumping vast distances with heights. They thought the sight was very interesting, and they were most amused by all the big kangaroos hopping about, some with little kangaroos in front of them nestled within pouches on their mother's stomachs. There were also teenager kangaroos jumping and playing together, while others tried their hands at boxing matches with every kangaroo that was game. The sight was a curiosity for Glacia and Snowglow. Who could not stop staring at all the kangaroos that seemed to almost fly through the air as they leapt from forth into the wind, which took them even further still. Grins of happiness spread across the polar bears' faces as they looked on at the sights before them. They cocked their ears and wiggled their tails while they continued to look. The kangaroos about had not yet taken notice of Snowglow and Glacia. Because the kangaroos were quite a bit to the north of where the bears were standing, like two cotton balls in the tall grasses surrounding them, a sudden wind shift out of the southwest caused the kangaroos to stop in mid-leap, as it were, for they sensed the polar bears as the wind caught their scent, carrying it right to their sniffers. The kangaroos spun about to see what the odors were that had carried to their noses. Then they beheld the two puffed-up polar bears standing on the bluffs, looking straight back at them. Off they went like lightning streaks across the grassy plains, fleeing inland. In less time than it takes for a flea to jump on a dog's tail, the kangaroos had all but disappeared from sight completely. There was not a hint or a rustle or anything at all to indicate that the place had just been filled with kangaroos playing, jumping, leaping, boxing, or anything else whatsoever. The place was completely evacuated, without so much as a trace of a kangaroo in sight. Glacia and Snowglow meandered along, touching shoulders as they sniffed here and there along their way, heading inland after the kangaroos, but not to follow them necessarily. They wanted to explore the beautiful Australian countryside, and so they did. The air was cool from the ocean breezes, and it was filled with luscious aromas of eucalyptus trees and gum trees, to mention a few. These pleasant aromas were like magnets to the bears as they followed their noses to the trees further inland. They made good time getting to the little forest of trees here and there. The eucalyptus was most pungent and nice-smelling to Glacia and Snowglow. They sharpened their front claws on the trees and left some of their scents from their fur rub onto the trees as they marked their new territory as their own. The two bears both sensed a presence near them and looked up the tree together, where they found an adorable koala bear well above their heads, nestled in the leaves, peeking down at them curiously. The inland heat was beginning to creep into the small forest of trees, and Snowglow told Glacia, "This heat is tough. Maybe we should go back to our island." Glacia just sniffed her nose at him as she replied, "I smell another new smell that I must look into, and it seems to be just beyond those low hills over there." She pointed her nose in an easterly direction that would bring the bears further inland and further from the shore. They contemplated whether or not to continue on still. In a unanimous motion of agreement, they launched forward toward some ancient aboriginal sacred red clay and sand and rock formations. With a scattering of trees with sparse leaves here and there, as the scene opened up before them with the intense heat that followed, the bears were spellbound in their tracks. The sacred place was brimming over with scents of various animals and people which seemed to transcend time. Ancient rites and rituals performed here over the centuries had left their mark on the entirety of the place. All Glacia and Snowglow could do was stand where they were, drink in the smells and feelings of the place, and become more and more enchanted with the place. The ocean breezes returned and rippled through their long fur and began to cool them off even more than before. Snowglow said, "The wind is cool now, but we still don't have much time to be here because we need to be moving along." Glacia nodded her head in agreement with him, so they sat there on the hot ground with red clay and earth beneath them, with the cool breezes encircling them. The bears let their minds wander here. They had a sense of complete fulfillment and happiness here together in this very place where the ancient past met the present, and together they merged, making the bears feel like they were suspended in a vacuum place where there was neither space or time, just the here and now. The earth seemed to reach up to them through their toes as it provided them with new strength and courage to face their future, whatever it might be. The magical red earth had worked its job, giving the bears the heart, strength, and fortitude that would take them further on their journey towards the home they had never forgot, the foothills of the Great Denali Mountains in Alaska, USA, America. Glacia and Snowglow got wind of a yearly event just around the southwest of Australia's continent. The migration of seals into the Port Lincoln area was part of a yearly event where killer whales blocked migrating seals in the harbor and taught their calves how to hunt for them. The killer whales depended on the migration of seals to keep their own lives going. The seal population was greatly reduced in this manner. Snowglow and Glacia did not want to be left out of this event because they were very hungry for seal meat. As the polar bear's iceberg rounded the Australian continent, moving towards the famous harbor, Glacia and Snowglow's excitement grew. It was fortunate for them to be at the right place and the right time to participate in the seal hunt along with the killer whales, also known as orcas. They waited until they were closer to the harbor before they both belly flopped from the tallest tip of their iceberg into the harbor depths. The splash was incredible as Glacia and Snowglow landed in unison and began their seal hunt amid the killer whales. The killer whales were surprised and a little bit annoyed that the polar bears were invading their territory and seal hunting grounds. Snowglow and Glacia paid no attention to the whales and swam on to claim seal meat of their own. A short while later, the polar bears had captured a big seal and brought it back to their icy island. There they ate it all up, except for the bones. Then they lay on the top of their iceberg and sunned themselves with tummies sticking way out. With full bellies, Snowglow and Glacia were ready to face anything that would come their way. Antarctica. This is the one of several encounters with two polar bears named Snowglow and Glacia and their adventures together on the Alaskan terrain and elsewhere. This volume takes the friends of the coldest place on Earth, Antarctica. These two polar bears become iconic in their lives and a legend in their lifetimes together. It takes special bears to accomplish this feat, but they do it with grace and dignity. Learn about the secret lives of polar bears with new twists that mingle their lives with others. Come and explore new friends for life with two cuddly and intellectual polar bears like never before known in history. The iceberg moved out slowly into the vast Indian Ocean. As it seemed to waver in its direction south toward the Antarctic land of frosty wonder, a typhoon loomed up, coming out of the northwest. It spurned on the iceberg, home of the polar bears, and churned up the seas. The ocean waves rose up and out in long, high waves with equally deep swells. As giant of an iceberg as it was, Glacia and Snowglow still felt their home rise and fall as it tried to ride the waves without sinking into the swells. Glacia peeked above her giant white paws at Snowglow and sighed before she said, "We could be traveling like this for some vast time." "This storm seemed like it is set in tight." Snowglow nodded his head up and down as he agreed with her. She was right. The storm was mighty, and it was steadily getting worse as they seemed to race toward the South Pole on their iceberg. Days turned to night and back again as the bears made great time in their travels, moving in a southerly direction. The bears were courageous and seemed content with their lot as they snuggled even closer to one another. The ceaseless high motion of the waves rolled the iceberg along at terrific speeds, and the winds 25 miles above them roared at turbo velocities of almost 500 miles per hour. The bears were a sight to behold, snuggled up together, bundled up in their thick polar bear fur. Presently, they peered at one another as the lights shined from within. Their love was deep and sincere, and it grew with every day. Glacia and Snowglow would always be inseparable. Absolutely nothing on earth could ever come between them. They would see things through life together, whether good or bad. One thing certain was that they would see things through with each other. They were ready to give up their life if necessary to protect the other. Their love was timeless. The iceberg virtually veered onward to the South Pole, as if it were attracted to the gravitational magnetic pole that was the coldest and harshest place on the planet. After days of traveling at high speed south to the Antarctic, through increasingly frigid and glacier-cooled oceans, the iceberg began to slow its pace. The polar bears were on the verge of the great continent that was almost the size of Australia. They had arrived at the Ross Sea, a giant cove-like gulf on the northern side of Antarctica. The bears emerged out from their den and were immediately assailed with temperatures that were colder than they had ever experienced in their short lives. The temperatures were so cold that Glacia and Snowglow had to claw the snow off their noses every 10 minutes or so just to breathe. They slid off their iceberg into the Antarctic Sea to swim to the glacier continent, similar in size to the continent they had just left, Australia. On the way to shore, they saw crab-eater seals, leopard seals, Antarctic fur seals, Ross seals, Weddell seals, and the southern elephant seals all around them in the ocean. Once on land of the great continent of Antarctica, with all its wonders, animal life, and few plants that existed there, they had an opportunity to look about. The mosses, grasses, and one or two other plants that did live in such a harsh environment looked scant here and there. Seal paradise was not lacking, though, for hungry polar bears. Snowglow and Glacia didn't waste a minute as they worked in unison to corral an old leopard seal that had lived its life out to natural completion and was about to croak of natural causes. This seal was the target for Glacia and Snowglow as they swam toward together to hunt it down for dinner. Snowglow brought the leopard seal to shore, where he and Glacia ate it like two ravenous birds. They had been so hungry during their long voyage from Australia to the Antarctic continent that they were on the verge of starving. The seal gave them the fat and nutrients they needed to live and continue on their journey around the planet. They noticed a lot of mosses, lichens in black, white, and green, thick matted grasses that faced the north, a flowering herb and algae hidden in a little rocky area, away from everything else. It looked like it was there by mistake. The animals and birds they saw were a curiosity to the bears, too. They saw birds like the Antarctic terns, snow petrels, brown skuas, Cape pigeons, a few wandering albatrosses, and sheathbills. The great wandering albatross was the most majestic bird of all. Out at sea from the corner of their eye, Glacia and Snowglow had caught glimpses of mammals such as killer whales, southern bottlenose dolphins, sperm whales, humpback whales, blue whales, the largest whale in the world, and fin whales. The penguins about them in the outreaching areas were Adelie penguins, Gentoo penguins, chinstrap penguins, rock hopper penguins, and the great emperor penguins. The polar bears rested on the ice after cleaning their fur and waited for the seal meat to begin digesting in their stomachs. Snow Glow spoke first. Glacia, we were fortunate to find such a good meal. This seal should last us for weeks or longer if we don't find more food. Do you think we should hunt here once more before we go back to our iceberg? Glacia perked up her ears as she listened to Snow Glow. Then she replied, yes, we must try to eat again if we can before we leave this great land. They looked around them and saw penguins of all sorts playing on the ice. The white snow was pebbled with dark spots that were penguins or seals resting on land. This was a polar bear's paradise, with enough seal meat to last forever. But Glacia and Snow Glow were on a mission that would take them back to the Arctic region and the Alaskan Denali mountain range. As they looked about themselves, they took note of the different kinds of plants they saw, which were mainly the clusters of thick matted grasses facing the north. The racket of the penguins from their distant rookeries and resting areas was loud and audacious, seeming to never cease. Even with the relentless Antarctic winds that blew the bear's fur all about them, drying it out before it froze stiff on their bodies, Glacia and Snow Glow made a makeshift den among some Antarctic rock formations that helped to block the relentless icy winds from smacking them nonstop. The bears found just the right spot within a few hours of arriving on land. They nestled down for the day, and the only light to be had was the moonshine lighting the late winter snow above them. Day or night, the sun was still shining full time in the opposite end of the globe at the Arctic Circle. Here it was beginning to be fall, and the landscape was new and glistening as it shone in the light of the now rising moon. Glacia and Snow Glow were in no hurry to get onto their iceberg. As they explored the interior of the Antarctic regions of their new world, the looming mountains of Markman and the Antarctic were mesmerizing to them, and the stars that shined out in the dark seemed like they could leap upon them and fly away straight up to heaven. The stars above shone like the stars in their eyes, and the magic of the place was not to be measured. The days blended into one another as Snow Glow and Glacia frolicked in the icy wonderland and chased the penguins that rested on land or guarded the rookeries. The seasons were changing, and the bears had spent a long time exploring this wondrous land. Home began to beckon them once more. Snow Glow and Glacia knew instinctively that it was time to leave the great Antarctic continent. They fed well on a carcass of an elephant seal before setting off for their iceberg island ship, resting in Ross Cove. They arrived at their icy floating island and shook like mad, ridding the seawater from their fur until they were nearly dry. Then they made their way to their den and settled in for a long nap to rest their tired brains. As they nestled further and further into a deep and glorious sleep, their iceberg began its traveling travels heading west and then northwest. The South Pacific Ocean currents grabbed a hold of the iceberg and pulled it into its gravitational force as it launched the polar bears along with it, as though it were a slingshot. The ocean currents with the magnetic south pole pull sent the bears into the Bellingshausen Sea in a rush with a powerful thrust of force. The thrust from this energy burst of the south pole sent the bears bearing across the seas. It saved a lot of time travel across the sea, as the polar bears made great haste towards the Atlantic Ocean off the coast of South Africa. Africa. The iceberg hurled past the Ivory Coast at the tip of South Africa as it swung toward Africa's central western coast. The bears woke up well before the iceberg moved them into these seas off of West South Africa. As the bears appeared from their den, the sunlight nearly blinded them. They crouched down low and backed into their den to reemerge very slowly as their eyes began to adjust to the sun's glare. As vision cleared up for them, they saw a grand sight to their immediate east, the continent of Africa. Glacia's nose quivered with excitement as the odors off the continent drifted past her nose. Snowglow's eyes shone and his ears perked up. He was absorbing the scents from land, too. They smelled things they had never experienced before. Wafts of high mountain lakes and high rising waterfalls drifted their way. Sand dunes and deserts and high mountain air that kissed the sun came their way. The smell of animals of all kinds assailed their senses and boggled their minds. They smelled lions, elephants, gorillas, monkeys, birds, zebras, and many more. They were so excited about all the aromas coming their way that they could barely stand still as they waited for their iceberg to slow in a chilly spot just south of the equator. They stretched and yawned and stretched some more as they readied themselves for the long swim from their iceberg to the African coast. Luckily for Glacia and Snowglow, the climate in Africa at the time of their arrival was about late winter and still cool enough for them to get about the continent pretty much as well as they pleased. The temperatures would be uncomfortable at times, and they would seek shelter in wooded groves and forests to find the coolness they required to survive any bouts of heat spells. Glacia and Snowglow had landed on shore south of the equator, just north of the Congo River in Africa. They were elated to stretch out their legs and necks as they strode along the Congo River, heading upstream. Their journey in Africa would take them to the very heart of Africa and to some of the most fantastic places on the planet Earth. Glacia told Snowglow, "We will have the time of our lives here in Africa, and we will see some things that we will surely never ever forget. Just me and you, my dear Snowglow." Snowglow shook his assent as he happily strode forth with his sweetheart Glacia. Snowglow was the first one to see a wild elephant and said, "Oh my, Glacia, look at that huge animal. Go stealthily by him so he does not chase us." The two bears silently moved past the giant elephant. The polar bears enjoyed their walk through the Congo. As they went upriver on a long trek, moving towards Lake Victoria in eastern Africa. Along the great Congo River, they learned some amazing facts. They discovered that it was the deepest river in the whole world because it was 700 feet deep in some areas. They knew of the elephant electric fish that may change the way medicine and neurology would be viewed. The Congo River was also the only one in the world with 60 miles of rapids. Since rapids are a type of water of falls, some people believe the Congo to have the longest falls too. The pair took their time along the way and enjoyed the sights and sounds of Africa everywhere they went. They saw many more elephants, peacocks, West African crown birds, and the boa boa tree in the evening sunset. As Snowglow and Glacia made their way further into the African interior, they made sure of avoiding people as much as possible. They also realized that it was no wonder that most hurricanes seem to originate off the western shores of this beautiful continent, for the weather here in Africa was all kinds. The rainy season was now upon the plains, and most of the places they ventured. Sunshine was mild when the sun did smile on the earth. The weather was almost otherworldly, with clouds rising high into the heavens and rainbows dancing across the forests and dipping into the rivers. Snowglow and Glacia made good time through Africa, without even trying to do so. Nothing in Africa seemed to daunt the polar bears, not even the heavy clouds of mosquitoes that often swarmed them along their journey. Over a period of about 3 months had gone by when Glacia and Snowglow came upon the majestic Victoria Falls and watched the monkeys swinging from the trees above and the baboons. The falls laughing and shouting as they played the day away. These monkeys and baboons were very playful and full of mischief, and they knew how to bring attention to themselves by throwing sticks and leaf trimmings over the edge of the falls and at each other. The Great Falls was spectacular. As the bears viewed the delightful sight, with the sunlight dancing off the cascading water falling to the White Nile River below, the headwaters of the Great Nile. The huge Mount Kilimanjaro loomed above everything as it seemed to rise straight up to heaven itself at a staggering height of 15,092 feet tall. The top of the mountain appeared like a plateau, as though the giant had recently blown its top. It is the tallest mountain in Africa and is not completely inactive, as gases emit from the crater periodically and magma of molten lava lay hundreds of feet below the crater bed. The volcanoes, actually three large overlapping stratovolcanoes, layered upon one another. Everywhere the polar bears went, Mount Kilimanjaro seemed to follow them, and they did not know what to make of this phenomenon. Glacier and Snowglow found themselves in awe of this ancient mountain and kept looking at it everywhere they went. They could not always see it because of clouds that shrouded the top of it. The mountain had the special ability that high mountains held, and that was the ability to create their own climates, pulling moisture out of the air as swirling clouds danced around their tops. Sometimes Glacier and Snowglow would come upon some especially touching scenes before them. The other day they had come upon a pair of giraffes standing beneath some boa boa trees as the sun was setting, and the day before that they had seen a giant lone male king of the jungle elephant under another beautiful tree silhouetted by the sun. Each polar bear had an ancient timeless light within their eyes as they looked upon each of these sights. For they knew, as beautiful as Africa was in the rainy season, they still traveled many places where the sun shone brightly, though not generally accompanied with the heat waves that dominate the continent much of the time in other seasons. Glacier and Snowglow were elated to be in Africa, and Africa would now always be dear to their hearts. But it was nearing the time when they must return to their trip toward home. They dilly-dallied and stalled as long as they could before they turned their faces back towards Western Africa. Snowglow led the way back to their iceberg, which they hoped would still be waiting offshore for them to swim to. Glacia was close behind him, as her nose frequently touched Snowglow's shoulder or licked his ear as they walked. The trip back west was as eventful as it had been when they headed up the Congo River, because coming one way and then seeing it from another direction made it look all new and interesting all over again. They made good progress on their travels and preferred to travel by night versus day, and as they walked, their senses told them the story of what had transpired since they had last passed through this area. The animals, reptiles, birds, and insects left their pheromones behind everywhere they went. Snowglow and Glacia took in all the information from these pheromones, chemical scents created by the animals, and they read other odors left behind these critters as well. The bears collected all the signs, smells, and signals of pheromones to create images in their brains, interpreted like a TV show for them to see all that had transposed occurred during their absence. Glacier and Snowglow saw in their mind's eye the entire happenings of the areas they moved through, heading to their happy den on the iceberg out at sea. Everything was safe and sound all the way back to the coast. Snowglow and Glacia scanned the seas offshore, trying to find their iceberg. Finally, Glacia saw it just to the north, out at sea, about a mile from shore. She said, "Snowglow, I see it over there to the north at 10 o'clock low." This meant that if the location were to be compared to a clock, it would be north and northwest. They were happy to see the sea and their mode of transportation. Snowglow motioned to Glacia with a happy swish of his giant head that it was time. They raced north on the beach before swimming out to their iceberg. Snowglow had a slight head start up the beach, with Glacia not far from his heels. they reached the beach nearest to their iceberg and launched themselves like white missiles into the oncoming waves. They pierced the waves with such skill and perfect harmony that no trace was left behind them. They climbed onto the iceberg, danced a happy jig, and kissed noses. Then watched Africa as it slowly faded off into a blurry haze. Africa was now behind them, and they were now the wiser and happier for the experience. They sailed the high seas with the high points of the iceberg as their sails. They were making good headway towards South America, moving through the South Atlantic Ocean. Their course was set at a latitude of 15 to 30 degrees south and a longitude of 30 degrees west. If the ocean current kept up at its present speed of approximately 45 miles per hour, they would reach the tip of South America in good time. The bears were on their way to South America. Unless the wind changed its course, the ocean its current, or some other mishap, the trip would go on as planned. South America. The days went by like magic. The seas were just right. As they reached the halfway mark to South America, then a hurricane that developed off the coast of Western Africa began to stir up the seas. The hurricane was out of season. It ought not to have developed, but it did. The oceans began to churn and spit foam high into the air. The crests on each wave seemed to stand on end, reaching up to the heavens like fingers from the earth. The wind rose, the temperatures dove, and the seas reared up higher yet. Snowglow and Glacia felt as if once more they were riding the crests of the waves, themselves rather than the sea. They were approaching treacherous waters and climate as they neared the tip of South America. The iceberg shuddered as clashing ocean currents battled it out with the high winds, creating whirlpools that wanted to suck the whole iceberg into its giant mouth. The iceberg was on the outside perimeter of the whirlpool, edging slowly towards the center. It would take more than a miracle to rescue the bears from this nightmare. The miracle came in an unexpected light. A typhoon out of the South Pacific Islands was churning the seas thousands of miles to the northwest. As the typhoon gathered intensity and strength, it rushed the swells at turbo velocity speeds towards South America. In the nick of time, the swells surged upon the South American continent, where the bears were fighting for their lives, clinging to one another in their den for dear life. The swells broke up the whirlpools and released the bears and their iceberg from its grip of sure death and destruction. Snowglow and Glacia said their prayers. Thank you, dear God, for our rescue from near death. Glacia and Snowglow were still trembling from their whirlpool experience and slowly regained their composure and natural self-assurance. After the iceberg was released from the grip of the whirlpool, it sprang into the current that just broke up the whirlpool. The current was so strong, it hurtled along the southwest shore, moving up towards central South America. Glacier and Snowglow emerged out of their den as the swollen seas seemed to mellow. They looked east towards the wonderful land and once more read the story of the land as the smells rode the winds towards the bears' noses. The odors were like a culinary kitchen with millions of items to select from. The bears' noses would try to follow a particularly nice scent that captured their fancy for as long as they could. Was that sweet potatoes roasting with caramelized sugars and pork coming their way? Glacia almost fell off her elevated perch on a raised area of the iceberg as she tried following the scents with her nose and body. Snowglow nuzzled her back onto her perch and took up the scent with his nose, own nose. He had a look of sheer heaven on his face as he turned to Glacia and said, "Darling Glacia, I think we will want to stay here for a good while. Look at the beautiful land and ant mountains. What fun we will have exploring this wondrous place." Glacia could only nod her head in firm agreement. The sheer joy of having webbed skin between your toes, like polar bears have. Snowglow and Glacia flexed their claws and stretched out their limbs like two cats, all hunched up. They had been cooped up so long in their den during the extreme weather conditions along their journey from Africa to South America. They now felt free like two birds ready to take wing. More like two fish taking to the sea, really. Snowglow and Glacia knew instinctively that it was time to swim for land. They hurtled themselves into the icy seas of the great South Pacific and paddled for land. It was now full on winter here, and in this particular place there were ample numbers of seals and dolphins that stayed year round in these pristine waters. Snowglow and Glacia hunted for seal meat on their way to shore. They each caught one and brought it ashore, where they ate it ravenously. The seals were ancient ones that had pretty much finished out their natural lifespans. The food gave the young polar bears the nourishment they so badly needed to continue to thrive. On the rugged and rocky shoreline of off ancient Patagonia, now called Argentina, and Chile, they rested and looked at the hues of blues and glacier formations of rocks all around them. The ocean was still choppy and always icy cold, but it held them in awe as they looked upon the scenery before them and all around them. The bears resumed exploring the country, heading north on the Chilean shore. Then they went northeast and followed a route that took them to a high mountain pass through the Andes called the Cordillera de los Andes. The mountains were high and the winds blew ferociously, as it seemed to try burrowing into their thick, luxurious fur coat. The blizzard wind seemed to have an electric current in it that energized Glacia and Snowglow. As it propelled them along the pass and into the lush country on the eastern side of the great Andes, they came around to exotic waterways and rainforests filled with all kinds of tropical fish, birds, and animals, just as they had seen on the western side of the Andes. They crossed large bodies of rivers, lakes, and streams until they got to the northern area of Chile. Along the way, Glacia and Snowglow saw many interesting animals, such as anteaters, monkeys, leopards, chinchillas, guinea pigs, rabbits, peacocks, and quetzal birds with shimmering green feathers, as well as parrots and more. They saw bats and all kinds of different animals they had never seen before. This was because there are more different kinds of plants and animals in South America than anywhere else on the planet. Animals of various kinds were hidden and blended into the habitat so well that it was hard to find many of them. But Snowglow and Glacia were no ordinary bears, and they could tell where even the most camouflaged creatures stirred or remained as still as a rock. The plants were just as numerous and extraordinary to look upon for the polar bears. Orchids, blooming in rainbows of colors, cocoa trees with their beautiful cocoa pods ready to be made into chocolate, organic chocolate, palm trees, and trees that flowered and trees that did not. The plants were the homes of many animals and insects and spiders. Giant lily pads floated on huge lakes, sporting 6 foot long, 6 foot wide pads and giant lilies. Mountains were all around them to their east and were often shrouded with high mountain clouds, ghost clouds, that covered them from midway up straight to heaven itself. The country was like coming home for the bears. It had many of the qualities that their homeland near the Arctic area had. This was like home away from home, which made Glacia and Snowglow feel very much at home. This country fit them very well. Here is where they stayed out of sight and hidden from people as much as possible. They explored them by moonlight and their acute senses every area of these vast countries. The vast area amazed them. Then they turned due east and continued until they reached Iguazu Falls and River. They had to pass through Brazil, Paraguay, and into Brazil. The falls were fantastic and filled Snowglow and Glacia with joy and enumeration as the negative ions filled the air and oxygenated their lungs with pure air. They had filled themselves with the joy and wonder of South America to their heart's content. Something in the wind told the polar bears that it was nearing the time when they must return to the sea and their iceberg. It was nothing tangible or anything. It was more of an instinctual thing that occurred to them, telling them they had been in this beautiful country long enough. True home in the great Northwest was beckoning them once more. So they reluctantly yet willingly began their long journey back on the trail they had made, retracing their footsteps once more. The days passed, then weeks, and still they had not reached the western coast of Chile. As Glacia and Snowglow came upon the great Pacific Ocean, they looked for their icy island and could not see it. they determined that it was likely to their north. So north they went. They padded along the rugged coast line and beaches, moving steadily northward toward Ecuador. When in Ecuador, the bear still had not seen their iceberg. They decided to swim towards the Galapagos Islands in search of their home away from home. They had eaten well before they headed out to sea, and when land seemed far behind them, they looked into the western ocean and saw, to their happy delight, the big white shape of their iceberg. They rested by swimming on their backs whenever they got tired, then flipped over and swam some more until they reached their icy island in the sea. Upon reaching their ice castle, they rested and contentedly with the assurance and confidence that comes with a job well done. They saw bats and all kinds of different animals they had never seen before. This was because there are more different kinds of plants and animals in South America than anywhere else on the planet. Animals of various kinds were hidden and blended into the habitat so well it was hard to find many of them. Snow Glow and Glacia were no ordinary bears, and they could tell where even the most camouflaged creatures stirred or remained, as still as a rock. The plants were just as numerous and extraordinary to look upon for the polar bears. Orchids blooming in rainbows of colors, cocoa trees with their beautiful cocoa pods ready to be made into chocolate, palm trees and trees that flowered and trees that did not. The plants were the homes of many animals and insects and spiders. This is a hibiscus. Mountains were all around them to their east and were often shrouded with high mountain clouds that covered them from midway up straight to heaven itself. The country was like coming home for the bears. It had many of the qualities that their homeland near the Arctic area had. This was like home away from home, which made Glacia and Snow Glow feel very much at home. This country fit them very well. Here is where they stayed out of sight and hidden from people as much as possible. They explored by moonlight, and their acute senses, every area of these vast countries. The vast area amazed them. Then they turned due east and continued until they reached Iguazu Falls and River. They had to pass through Brazil, Paraguay, and into Brazil. The falls were fantastic and filled Snow Glow and Glacia with joy and enumeration as the negative ions filled the air and oxygenated their lungs with pure air. And we'll move along to Galapagos Islands now. Galapagos. Well, shouldn't rush. They had filled themselves with the joy and wonder of South America to their heart's content. Something in the wind told the polar bears that it was nearing the time when they must return to the sea and their iceberg. It was nothing tangible or anything. It was more of an instinctual thing that occurred to them, telling them they had been in this beautiful country long enough. True home in the great Northwest was beckoning them once more, so they reluctantly yet willingly began their long journey back on the trail they had made, retracing their footsteps once more. The days passed, then weeks, and still they had not reached the western coast of Chile. As Glacia and Snowglow came upon the great Pacific Ocean, they looked for their icy island and could not see it. They determined that it was likely to their north, so north they went. They padded along the rugged coastline and beaches, moving steadily northward toward Ecuador. When in Ecuador, the bears still had not seen their iceberg. They decided to swim towards the Galapagos Islands in search of their icy home away from home. They had eaten well before they rested by swimming on their backs whenever they got tired, then flipped over and swam onwards. Galapagos. Glacia and Snowglow clambered up the iceberg, digging into it with their approximately 4-inch long claws as hoists to pull themselves up the ice wall on their home. The swim had been long and tiring for them, so they went into their den and rested contentedly. Hour after hour passed as the bears regained their strength. Night came as Snowglow peeked out of his sleep and softly nuzzled Glacia until she awakened too. Like two comets, they blazed out of their icy den, slid off the iceberg, and submerged themselves into the wild ocean waters surrounding the Galapagos Islands. These islands had formed over a millennium of years as the islands drifted northwest after they had formed from volcanic hotspots beneath the sea. Glacia and Snowglow swam beneath the sea as much as possible before coming up for oxygen. Then they would submerge again to explore the world that met their eyes. They saw giant Pacific green sea turtles, huge marine iguanas eating long string green algae from the seafloor. These big ones were the only ones with enough body heat to last them about 5 minutes underwater before they had to get back to land. Smaller marine iguanas could not survive the undersea water for any length of time because of their body temperature. They're cold-blooded, they needed to be warm by the sun. Other creatures they saw and were keenly interested in were the fur seals, California sea lions, rays, sharks, bottle-nosed dolphins, hammerhead sharks, and hawksbill sea turtles, and more. Excitement mounted in the bears' hearts and their appetites as they prepared to hunt seals for dinner. They worked quick and well, captured two seals and hauled them ashore, where they polished them off over the next day. too full to move, they just looked about themselves, investigating the countryside they were resting on. They saw little red land crabs and more iguanas sunning themselves on the rocks near the shore. As the food slid further down their stomachs, the bears could move about more freely, so they set about to explore the island. The landscape was very interesting, almost like a desert, with not much shrubbery or giant trees. There was a lot of grasses blowing in the steady wind and interesting smells assailing their nostrils. Glacia and Snowglow both caught the scent of the numerous giant 600-pound tortoises roaming about the island, inland areas of the island. The tortoises were very amusing to the bears, who had never walked up to one before. Snowglow walked up to a huge tortoise and sniffed right at where its head ought to be. But the clever tortoise had quickly withdrawn it into his shell, where he felt safe and secure from anything outside of it. Snowglow licked the shell to see if he might like to eat it, but the shell did not appeal to him. Glacia tried a lick at the big tortoise's shell and said, "Yucky, I don't like this flavor at all, Snowglow. Want to play with him?" She went ahead to play with it by tapping her right front paw against his shell. Then she leapt backwards as fast as she could. Snowglow did the same thing, and the tortoise went backward too. The bear circled the tortoise and came back around to circle him from the other direction. The tortoise began to elude his predators by circling around himself. Then he peeked out of his shell for a microsecond before he popped it back inside. Glacia and Snowglow were extremely amused with this play, but they were suddenly distracted by a flock of noisy, colorful finches who were communicating with each other about something very important. Snowglow and Glacia stared at the birds with the beautiful red and brown colors and wondered what all the squawking was about. They tilted their heads from one side to the other in wonder. Then they saw what the birds were upset about. Just yonder was another group of competitive green and brown-colored finches trying to get close to their tree and abscond with their fruits that covered it. The first group of finches were defending their fruit and territory from the second group of finches trying to sneak up on them to take it over for themselves. The red and brown finches just succeeded in driving off the green and brown finches and were making merry triumphant chirps, whistles, and clicking noises to proclaim victory over their adversaries. Snowglow and Glacia had been watching the whole event while the big tortoise had moseyed off to a much safer distance from the two strange white bears who had been pestering him to no end. Glacia began to move further inland with Snowglow right behind her. They went to a tall rise of land, which wasn't quite a mountain, and looked about. There were trails all over the rise of land, and many huge tortoises were moving along the trails. These trails must be ancient, because they made ruts in the earth from usage over the centuries. The trails led to some watering holes at the bottom, where the tortoises and other wild animals came to drink. Only one tortoise was at the drinking hole, and she was a grandma tortoise. So old was she that she didn't give a hoot who was near her. When she saw the two white polar bears within her sight of vision, she just ignored them and went on drinking her water as though they were not even there. Snowglow and Glacia decided to look at other things on the island, and off they went to explore. The animals were beautiful and exotic to look upon, and the bears were enthralled with the kinds of creatures they saw, such as birds of paradise, chameleons, black-browed albatross, the tiny blue penguins, and blue-footed boobies. Then they lay eyes on the blue penguin, standing all of 1 foot tall or so in height. Amazing, they thought. They saw the Galapagos pelican, Nazca boobies, Galapagos hawks, and the lava gull birds, and even land iguanas. Snowglow and Glacia had seen so many different kinds of animals that they had not seen before. There's also the Komodo dragon, which is very big, and it's spit can cause great harm. All the animals were very intriguing to the bears, but they were getting ready to retire to their den. A rush of warm air assailed them, which was immediately followed by a typhoon blast of cold air. The bears knew instinctively that they must return to their ice palace out at sea. They marched to the rocky shore and leapt into the depths of the Galapagos Sea. Even the sea had drastically changed since their arrival here. With great haste, muscles churning away at the sea and paddling with all their might, Snowglow and Glacia swam to their iceberg and arrived in the nick of time. A typhoon was upon them. As they entered their snug and cozy den to snuggle up together like two fur balls, happy and safe from all the world, the bears were off once again to a new adventure. They were now headed to North America with an unprecedented current shoving them northward at astronomically high speeds that reached over 75 miles per hour. The sea was like a live thing flinging the iceberg north, ever north. Alaska, home sweet home. Glacia and Snowglow clambered up the iceberg, digging into it with their approximately 4-inch claws as hoist to pull themselves up the ice wall to their home. The swim had been long and tiring for them, so they went into their den and rested contentedly. Hour after hour passed as the bears regained their strength. Night came as Snowglow peeked out of his sleep and softly muzzled Glacia until she awakened too. The iceberg continued on its northern path, heading up the Washington coast, past the Canadian shore and into Alaska. Days were lovely now, no matter what the time of year was, because they had arrived back at their birthplace and their old cub stomping grounds. They were truly back home in Alaska, where it really was the best of all places in the whole entire world, because it was where their birthplace home was. The iceberg rolled forth further into the northern icy ocean as Snowglow and Glacia hopped off east of the Denali Range. They paddled with happy expressions on their faces and could not stop grinning for the life of them. Their hearts sang out loud and clear, "We're home, we're home, we're home at last." So they were home, and they had to do all they had to do was get to the foothills of the Denali Mountains to find their mothers. They skipped and danced all the way home. Their mothers had sensed the near return of their children and were waiting expectantly by their old den sites as their cubs rejoined their moms. Big bear hugs and nuzzling of noses proceeded from mother to cub and cub to mother until they were all caught up with kisses and loving nudges. Glacia and Snowglow took turns telling their mothers about their long adventures that ultimately took them clear around the earth. They told of the wonders of Japan, China, India, Australia, Antarctica, Africa, South America, the Galapagos Islands, and last but not least, North America, and their home in the Great Alaska. Snowglow and Glacia said together, "We have seen the wonders of the beautiful places of the world, and we have seen humans everywhere we have been." Snowglow and Glacia both spoke to their moms simultaneously. "Mom, wait until you hear where we've been," Snowglow said. "We went to Japan, where we saw Mount Fuji and all the beautiful gardens filled with ponds and flowers. Then we went to China, where we saw a panda bear and heavenly lakes and waterfalls. Then we went to India and saw the tallest mountains in the world. The sight is still in my mind when I think about it, and the cold, how very icy cold it was up there." Glacia intervened with, "You should have seen Krakatoa and Australia's Great Barrier Reef with all the undersea life and corals of all kinds. The western coast of Australia and the interior were spectacular. We saw koalas and kangaroos." Snowglow added, "Then we were off to Antarctica, where it is the coldest place on earth. All the penguins and sea mammals were everywhere. The ice shone like facets of blue and white diamonds and crystals, oh so pretty to look at." Glacia inserted, "Oh my, Mama, I fell in love with Africa. I loved the elephants, the giant Victoria Falls in eastern Africa, called Mosioa Tunya before it was ever discovered by Europeans. It is one of the seven wonders of the world." "We went to the Galapagos Islands off the coast of Ecuador and swam with the sea turtles and marine iguanas." Snowglow looked around him, beginning with his sweetheart Glacia, and said, "But you know what, guys? There is absolutely nothing like home sweet home, is there, Glacia?" Glacia looked at Snowglow and their mother, saying, "Right, Snowglow, you are oh so very right." Then all the bears hugged each other very tight and purred loud, happy noises. That seemed to resonate far and wide on the Alaskan tundra. The day had been long and beautiful, and the golden raspberry sunset with streaks of lavender and gold danced above them until they changed to liquid gold. Then the northern lights came out to play, a dance of ballet lights across the Alaskan landscape. Dreamy happy eyes filled with more joy as the polar bears celebrated their country before they each went to bed in their dens for the night. Tomorrow would soon be here, but for now, the night was a soft black velvety warmth that gently led the bears to dreamland. "We want to spread the word to all living creatures that our world is precious, fragile, and in need of care and love from everyone. When humans care about the earth and help to take care of it, the world will be a healthy place for everyone. All the polar bears agreed with each other. They all had a job to do, so every time they came upon anybody, they would talk about the earth needing love and nurturing, so that they would share their story with their creatures and humans, with other creatures and humans, by telling them about it too. One bear may not be able to do very much, but when everyone works together for the better, then everyone cares about it together. Healthy planet for healthy inhabitants. And the little panda peeking from the bamboo trees was one of the loveliest sights of all. Epilogue Polar Bear Future. Snow Glow and Glacia know that the world their parents had known before they were born was changing forever. They knew that they would have to change too in order to survive in a world that was going through changes like global warming and other things. The world would always be in motion, and change was part of the world too. The inhabitants of the world that would survive would be the ones who could adapt to change best. Survivors and those that thrived seemed to have a varied diet as well as habitat. The people and animals willing to change as the earth changed were going to thrive best. Humans still have an impact on the world and global warming too. Every little thing that can help reverse global warming will help all the inhabitants of the earth.